Namaste and welcome back. In the last video, we have seen the symmetric key cryptography in which a key will be shared among all the participants in the network. The encryption and decryption will be done using the same key. So this is what the basic idea behind the symmetric key cryptography. In addition to this, we have seen the advantages and drawbacks of the symmetric key cryptography. The advantages is it preserves the basic confidentiality principle of cryptography, and most of the symmetric key algorithms are very simple and fast. At the same time, they also provide the authenticity. The main drawback is with the key management, such as key generation, key distribution, key refreshment and rekey. These are the four things that will come under the key management issues. These four issues cannot be dealt using symmetric key, because similar key is used by all participants who are participating in the communication. At the same time, another important concept or another important property of cryptography that is called non-repudiation cannot be achieved with the symmetric key cryptography. So in this video, I am going to present the asymmetric key cryptography, which will guarantee which will overcome the drawbacks of the symmetric key cryptography, which will give you the solutions for the key management, and which will ensure the repudiation, non-repudiation property of the cryptography. Asymmetric key cryptography is also called as public key cryptography. It was first realized in the middle of 1970s, and which was given by, or which was researched by, the Whitefield Deffie and Martin Hellman, which their name is also very famous as a Deffie-Hellman. So they have introduced this particular public key cryptography concept. The idea behind the public key cryptography or asymmetric key cryptography is, instead of using a single key in the symmetric key cryptography, in the public key cryptography, the participants will be having two keys, which are called as public key and a secret key or private key. So every participant is supplied with two keys. One is a public key, another is private key, or we can say this is also said to be secret key. So the name itself telling you the public key. In the given pair of keys, one key, that is public key, will be known to everyone. And private key is known to the person to whom this particular key pair is allotted. If any user wants to participate in the public key cryptography, first of all, he has to enroll with a key distribution center. That key distribution center will allocate a pair of keys called public key and private key. Each user public key is published in publicly. That means anyone can view the public key of any person. Whereas private key is kept secret. By creating the keys in this way, the need for shared symmetric key can be eliminated. The important feature of these two keys, public key and private key pair, is both keys can be used for encryption and decryption. In case of symmetric key cryptography, a single key is used for both for encryption and decryption. But in case of the public key cryptography, the key pairs, the given key pairs, public key and a secret key, can be used for encryption as well as decryption. So The classes of public key algorithms, if you look at, those are like public key distribution schemes in which this public key algorithms can be used. Public key encryption schemes in which the same asymmetric key cryptography can be used. At the same time, signature scheme. So by this time, you come to know that in symmetric key, only one key will be used, and the same key will be known to all participants in the communication. Where in case of asymmetric key or public key cryptography, every user will be supplied with a pair of keys. Those keys are said to be public key and secret key, and both keys are used for encryption and decryption. And a public key can be published to the that means the public key can be known to everyone, whereas private key will be kept secret with the corresponding user. And this public key algorithms can be used in three ways, like public key distribution schemes, public key encryption schemes, and signature schemes. We'll see these things in detail. One class of the public key distribution algorithms is public key distribution schemes. Public key algorithms is public key distribution, in which a key distribution center will do this public key distribution. In the sense, like in symmetric key cryptography, keys are just like a integer or some values. Here also, public key and private key or secret key pairs will be generated by some special mechanisms or some mathematical functions. For example, generated via bilinear pairs, or generated via some elliptic curves, etc. So via this, the keys will be generated, and these keys will be kept at the key distribution center, and whoever or whatever the user will request for participation in the communication, for them, this key distribution center will assign key pairs. That key pair means here public key and secret key will be given to the user. And this public key distribution schemes used to securely exchange a single piece of information with the keys supplied to the user. So how it will be done? It will be done with the proper encryption mechanism. And the key pair values are the corresponding things will be depending upon the two parties, that is the users who wants to exchange communication. And these values cannot be set at any time. That means the key values cannot be set at any time. And these values will vary dynamically. The reason is, as the communication need to establish between two users on the fly with the keys supplied or key pairs supplied to both the users, a special value will be generated, which is called session key. So with that session key, the communication will take place. So here the key pairs are independent to the users, but at the time of establishing the communication, the users will exchange the public keys, and then a session key will be maintained. With the session key, the communication takes place. So the value is normally used as a session key for a private key scheme. So that means there exists a center which will keep track of which will generate the keys, and whoever wants to participate in the communication, for them these keys will be given. And whenever the users want to establish communication, here public key distribution role will not come into picture, or public key center will not come into the picture. However, the communication will be established on the fly, and a session key will be created, and based upon the session key, the communication takes place. So next one is public key encryption schemes. Basically, these public key encryption schemes are used for encrypting of any message in order to maintain the confidentiality. So anyone can use the public key to encrypt a message. That means here, in this usage of the public key and secret key pairs, two things will come into the picture. One is many to one and one to many. That means anyone can encrypt a message, but only one person who is holding the secret key can decrypt the message. That is called many to one. Where in case of one to many, that means only one person can encrypt a message, but anyone can verify that particular message. So anyone can decrypt that message. This is called one to many. So public key encryption schemes will come under many to one. So here, anyone can use the public key to encrypt a message. Here, what is the meaning of this? For example, user 1 wants to communicate with the user 3. Now, user 3's public key and private key pair will be there with the user 3 itself. But the public key of the user 3 will be known to the user 1 by either by directly consulting user 3 or maybe by consulting the key distribution center. So user 1 will get the public key of user 3. Then using that particular public key, whatever the message he wants to communicate with user 3 will be encrypted and user 1 will send over the communication channel. Like that, any user in the communication system having the public key of user 3 can encrypt the messages and can send to the user 3. Thereby, whenever the user 3 receives the message, he can use his private key, or we can say secret key, to decrypt the message. So anyone like that, in this way, anyone can encrypt the message using the public key of a corresponding user and can send to the corresponding user. The particular user can use his private key and decrypt the message. So this is the what called many to one. So owner uses the private key to decrypt the message. Any public key encryption scheme can be used as a public key distribution scheme by using the session key as the message. Many public key encryption schemes are also signature schemes that I will discuss afterwards, which will provide both encryption and decryption can be done in either order. So this signature scheme is a kind of one to many scheme that I will discuss afterwards. So by this time you come to know that public key encryption scheme, that means in the supplied key pair, the public key is used to encrypt a message and can be sent to any of the to a particular user, and the user can decrypt the message using his private key. For example, in our case, user 1 has sent the encrypted message to user 3. But if any other user, like user 4 or user 5, have intercepted that message, then wants to decrypt, can they decrypt? So it is not possible to decrypt that message. The reason is, any message that is encrypted using a public key of a user, then only by using the private key of that particular user, that message can be decrypted. So this is the way how the confidentiality and authentication can be guaranteed with the public key and secret key pairs. Another thing is signature schemes. In the previous slide, we have seen the encryption of a message using public key and decryption of the encrypted message using the private key. which is called many-to-one scheme, where in case of a signature scheme, it is one-to-many. So the other, as we have seen previously, that the both public and private keys are used for both encryption and decryption. Now, this public key encryption schemes or public key algorithms can be used for signature schemes in which it is used to create a digital signature for some message. Here, a digital signature, in the sense, we might have seen if two or more parties, or if two parties wants to agree upon some conditions, they will write on a paper, they will write the terms and conditions on a paper, and both the parties will sign it, or if any one of them may sign it to agree the terms and conditions. So in future, if they violate the terms and conditions, they are liable to face any action which was mentioned in the terms and conditions. So afterwards, they cannot deny that this particular signature, this particular document was not signed by me, or this is no way related to me, like that. So for that, the signature which was put on the paper by that party is the evidence that he has agreed to the terms and conditions. So in a physical form, we can do like this. But in the case of digital communications, how can we do this? This is possible with the help of one-to-many mechanism. So in this, owner uses the private key to sign the signature. That means in the previous case, in the public key encryption algorithms, public key is used for encrypting the message. But here, owner will use his private key, or the user will use his private key to encrypt a message. So anyone who is having that particular encrypted message can decrypt using the public key of that particular user, so that anyone can come to know that, okay, this is the, he is the only person, or he is the, this is the only user has privately signed or signed using his private key. So thereby, that user cannot deny that I have not signed this particular message. The reason is, he is the only one holding the secret key. So thereby, anyone can verify whether he has really signed that particular message or not. So this is the way how the signature scheme will work using the public key encryption, public key algorithms. So anyone can use the public key of the user, of the signer or the owner, to verify the signature. So in this way, signature scheme will work. So for this, some of the signature schemes will take the help of the cryptographic hash functions that we'll see in the later next slides. And such kind of signatures are said to be digital signatures, or cryptographic signatures, or fingerprints, or digital representations. In the process of performing the encryption or digital certificate or verifications, etc., how then the important question need to be understand is, how do you know that who is owning a particular key? This is the most important thing. Otherwise, verification or encryption is not an easy task. So how do you know that a particular person or particular user owns a particular key? So this is what the important question need to be addressed. So this will be done with the help of digital certificate authorities. That means, or we can say, certificate authorities. It is the responsibility of the certificate authorities to issue a digital certificate to the corresponding user, or this particular digital certificate is a kind of electronic credential which is unique to a person, computer, or service, or application, okay, whatever the party that is involved in the communication. So when any of the party or user presented the certificate, then their credentials will be verified using the public key of the particular user. Then they will come to know that, okay, this is the person who, this is the user or this is the system or computer who owns this particular message or who owns this particular data. So this is the way how the digital certificates will help in validating that okay, this so and so person or so and so computer is holding this particular key. So in this way, the key verification will be done. So a digital certificate is a digitally sealed object that consisting of the fields such as version, serial number, algorithm ID, who is the issuer of the digital certificate, and validity of that particular digital certificate, what is the subject of that certificate, subject in the sense here, who is the person, whether a person or computer or service or whatever it may be. Subject's public key, what is the public key algorithm used, and others. Please remember here, whatever the public key encryption algorithms used are known to everyone. Either the public key algorithm may be a RSA algorithm or elliptic curve algorithms or whatever the algorithms it may be. Though all these algorithms are public and available on the public domains. But the users are safe or will be happy to use this particular public key algorithms by keeping their keys as secret. That means public key algorithms are known to anyone. The working procedure is available on the internet. Anyone can access it and anyone can see this. But only difficulty in this is the keys are kept secret. So here keys will play a major role. So the reason keys should not be disclosed at any cost. But public keys can be given to anyone, but secret key must be kept at secret. Secret key must not be disclosed. Whenever you want to create any digital certificate, not only this information, the ninth point in this is others. Means you can also include any other information in this. In general, what the digital certificate algorithms will do is they will combine these details into a file, and that file will be given to a hash function. That hash function will be encrypted using the private key of the issuing person. That means here, for example, a person X wants a digital certificate, then that X's details such as version, serial number, algorithm ID, and any other details will be kept in a file, and that file will be sent to a cryptographic hash function. Any cryptographic hash function will take any size input but will give a fixed length digest. That digest was encrypted using the X's private key. So thereby anyone can verify whether this is a valid digital signature or not with the help of the X public key. So thereby anyone will come to know that okay, this is the valid digital certificate received from X. So this is the way how the digital certificate will work. By and large, the public key infrastructure will look like this. Understand, observe the diagram in which we have the sender, certification authority. We have seen previously the certification authority. So the sender, from certification authority, certificate private keys will be received by the sender. The sender will sign this particular data and will be sent to the receiver. The verification authority will check whether the signature is okay or not. If the signature is okay, then this particular message is valid message and will be received by the recipient. And sender, all like other users, sender will also send a request to the registration authority. This registration authority will verify the details of the sender and will send the reply back to the certification authority. Upon receiving the reply from the registration authority, this request will be sent to the certification authority. Then the certification authority will issue the certificate private keys. and the same copy will also be sent to the verification authority. So any recipient will contact the verification authority, then the verification authority will check whether this particular message has come from the corresponding sender or not. If it is received and if the details of the sender, that is public key details of the sender, is used for verifying that particular message, since the message is signed using the private key of the sender, then this particular verification authority will issue that okay, the signature is okay. Then the recipient or the receiver will come to know that okay, this message is a valid message, came from corresponding sender. So this is the way public key infrastructure will work, in which the actions of the certification authority, here the certification authority is the core of the entire public key infrastructure. The actions of the certification authority is the generation of the key pairs. It is responsible for generating the key pairs. So next one is generation of certificates. So the certificate consisting of, we have seen in the previous slide that these are the details will be available in the certificate. Next is publication of the public keys. So this publication of the public keys means this public keys will be sent to the verifying authority. That means verifying authority consisting of all the public keys of the users who are participating in the communication. Next is validation of the certificate. So next one is revocation of the certificate. If the certification authority find that something messy happened in the thing, then it may also revoke the certificate. Next, what are the different type of certification authorities available? See, these types are root CA, root certification authority, trusted root certification authority, peer certification authority, subordinate certification authority, and registration authority. These are the categories of certification authorities. The name itself telling you that root CA, that means root certification authority, which is the apex certification authority, which is on top of the entire chain. That is, entire chain means this certification chain. So basically this root CA initiate all the trusted paths. That means root CA will sit on top of the entire chain, and which is very secured and protected. Where in case of trusted root CA means this trusted root CA is a certification authority that added to an application such as a browser by a software vendor. It signifies that the application vendor trusts the certification authority and assigns the entity at the high level of the trust. That means trusted root certification authority will be provided by the corresponding application. For example, if you are using a web browser, the web browser vendor, for example Mozilla or Google Chrome or something, they will give you the trusted root certification authority, which will sit on top of which will work just like your root CA for that particular web browser or a web application. Next one is on the other hand, the peer CA means that no one will give you the validation or certification. It is just like self attestation. Means anyone can self certify that what are the thing I am sending is self certified, just like that. So we have seen self attestation kind of thing in our daily life. So like that, a peer CA is, that means it's a certification authority that provides self signed certificate, and it distributes to the its certificate holders and used by them to initiate the certification path. So this is the way how the peer CA will work. But in case of subordinate CA is nothing but a child certification authority. This is not a peer certification authority, it's a child certification authority. So it has a very minimum usage in the public infrastructure, but however people still use it. The reason is certification trust or trust path cannot be initiated using the subordinate CA. So first path is always rooted from the root CA only. So the reason the subordinate CA will be called as the child CA. On the other hand, that is last one is registration authority. So registration authority is one that is an entry position between the client and the certification authority. So this registration authority is responsible for accepting the request from the users and verifying the person or system's identity and passing along the information to the certification authority are the responsibilities of the registration authority. So this is the way how the public key infrastructure system will work in any communication system. So it is not a simple system like symmetric key cryptography. It has a whole infrastructure. So that is the reason as an ethical hacker, you must understand the public key infrastructure. So there will be a different, component like certification authority or registration authority and verification authority. The ultimate aim of any hacker is to target any one of these component so that they can get the public keys and private keys of the communicating participants or users in the network. So with which they can perform or they can launch any cryptography based attacks or the data branches or etc. In order to build the public key infrastructure, the certification authority, registration authority, verification authority, such kind of components are required. In addition to this, the creation of the digital signatures is equally important. At the same time, along with the digital signature, one must also know how the hashing will be performed. So repeatedly I have discussed it in this video and previous video also that hashing is a cryptographic technique of converting a input of any size into a fixed size message digest. And this hashing is one way hashing. That means with the fixed size message digest that we got as the output, we cannot convert into a original message. So this reverse is not reversing of the message register is not possible. That is the reason such hash functions or hashing techniques are said to be one way hashing function. This one way hashing functions, this hashing functions are especially used to ensure that the content in the digital certificates are not tampered. So that means in order to maintain the integrity of the digital certificates, this hashing will be used. Now we'll see how this particular hashing will be used. You look at in this diagram, there is a hash function, cryptographic hash function, which is a one-way hash function. It will take a message of any arbitrary length. Then this hash function, what it will do is it will generate a hash value h with a fixed size length. And this hash value is also said to be message digest or some digest. So this message digest will be useful for verifying that whether any message has been changed or not. So for example, the same message m within brackets arbitrary length. If it is passed to any hash function, cryptographic hash function, it will give you a fixed size message digest. For example, if you might have changed this capital M to small m and run on the same hashing function, you will not get the same message digest that you got previously. The reason is even a small change, even a small gap also in the is mentioned in the original message, then you never get the same hash function for the changed message. So that is the reason even a small modification can also be detected with the help of this particular hash function. So if anyone changes the content in the digital certificate, then it can be easily identified with the hash value, because this hash value will be encrypted using the private key, and anyone is having this particular hash value can decrypt using the public key, and the same digital certificate content will be run on the cryptographic hash function, and they will get the message digest, and the message digest will be checked with the decrypted message digest, and if both are equal, then the digital certificate is valid, otherwise digital certificate is invalid. So this is the way how the hashing will help to verify non-repudiation. That means a user cannot deny that okay, I have not sent this particular message. So in this way, non-repudiation can be achieved with the help of cryptographic hash function and with the digital certificates. So if you look at hashing, there exist many hashing protocols, hashing functions, sorry, not protocols, it is a hashing functions available. The one is MD2, message digest. Wherever MD occurred, it is said to be message digest. MD2 algorithm, which is especially used in the privacy enhanced mail protocol along with the MD5 algorithm. And message digest 4, which is especially used for pretty good privacy and other systems. And MD5, which is a very famous message digest algorithm and is popularly used in many applications, the medium range applications. Next is MD6 algorithm. It was also in use but not in popularly used. Next is Havel algorithm, which is a modification of the MD5 algorithm. RIPEMD, message digest. This algorithm is especially used in the Europe countries for performing this hashing and all. Next is simple hash algorithm 0 version, simple hash algorithm 1, and simple hash algorithm 2. And in simple hash algorithm 2, there exists various different length message digests will occur. Where in case of MD5, if you look at there is 128. That means you give any message length, it may be of 2 bits or 3 bits, but you will get 128 bit fixed message digest. In the same way, SHA-1, SHA-2. In SHA-2, you will find various message digest lengths, such as 256, 224, 512, etc. The famous Bitcoin cryptocurrency uses SHA-2 algorithm. It uses a double hashing technique for ensuring the integrity of the transactions. So this is one example. So like that, depending upon the application, they use the hashing algorithm. And one more thing is, all these hashing algorithm working procedures are open. Anyone can view this working procedures. But with the message register, you cannot get the original message. This is what the specialty of the hashing techniques. So majorly, this hashing functions will be used by many of the computer systems for storing their passwords. They never save the passwords in terms of plain text. However, they use hashing techniques to convert into message digest, and they will save. Whenever user enters the plain text as the password, the operating systems of the corresponding computer are the application of the corresponding thing will run the hash function, and whatever the password you have entered will be run on the cryptographic hash function, and the message digest will be verified with the saved message digest. If both are equal, then the password is validated. So if any hacker identifies the password base, and if the password is in the cryptographic hash function, message digest, then it is not possible for the hacker to get the original message back, that is original passwords back. That is the reason this is a technique used by the many of the operating systems. So that is the reason you must know which operating system uses what type of hashing. So if the hashing message register code length is very very low or somewhat lower bit range, then there exists some specialized tools available which are useful for converting the message digest to the original message. So that is the reason, as an ethical hacker, you must know how these hashing functions will work. At least you should practice already existing or already available message register libraries, and just to pass the text into the message libraries into the function and see how the hash codes will be generated by the hash functions. So to summarize, in this video we have seen the public key infrastructure and public key encryption, public key algorithm, cryptography, in which we have seen the key distribution, encryption and signature schemes. Along with the signature, we have also seen the hashing, the role of hashing in the computer systems and applications for storing the passwords and preserving the data and checking the integrity of the data, and various hashing algorithms used, and public key infrastructure components, and all we have seen in this particular video. And as an ethical hacker, you must know the details of each and every thing that I have explained so far. I have explained in a brief way, but you must know in detail how they work and all. Since these are explanation of the details is not the part of our course, you may find some other courses where these details are available. Since as an ethical hacker, you must know the fundamentals of these concepts, I have made a review of all the things. And in the next video, we'll see some applications of the cryptographic things that what we have seen so far in the next video.